Ladies and gentlemen, honored guests, enthusiasts, purists, folks who love vehicles of all descriptions, and especially all of you from the Fort Worth GTO Club, it is a privilege to address you today. Roger, who has encouraged me to speak to you, has discovered that there are some interesting thoughts that will be covered today. Certainly, and most importantly is, for the first time in 47 years, you are going to see the only 1972 GTO convertible pace car ever made by Pontiac Advanced Engineering for Beloff Pontiac Cadillac GMC truck in Peru, Indiana, driven by the famous Doris King and her husband Grant King, who is the single largest producer of race cars, championship race cars, sprint cars, dirt cars in the country. It's interesting to note, when I look at GTOs of all descriptions, all of you folks should understand something for a moment. We're going back in history. It'd be pretty lame for us to say, a Model T Ford doesn't have air conditioning. It doesn't have an automatic transmission. Of course not. Well, some of our cars back in the 60s are the same way. But the three words, GTO, the three letters, GTO, are world famous. What's even more important is the impact that it's made on thousands of lives, because you see, you folks today are the vanguard. You're creating the legacy, not only today, but in the future, and for everyone who holds vehicles dear. Remember, the industrial heartland of the world was in Michigan, and it's gone. So what you're doing today, even by looking at one single vehicle, even if you had to push it, if it doesn't run, has great impact. Some of you may not know this. Bill Tate, who is our mayor in Grapevine, Texas, had a brand new 65 Pontiac GTO convertible, triple black, when he was in college. It was totaled in an accident through no fault of his. I'm sure he would not forget his wife's birthday, Betty, but he remembers vividly that 65 GTO convertible. Dick Jones is in our Rotary Club, had a brand new 67 GTO coupe, which of course, as many of you remember, was the first year for the turbo hydromatic. Dick was a young officer in the Air Force, married with children, and on very limited pay, made sure he had this new GTO convertible. Of course, Daryl Roach is the reason I'm here, because Daryl has an award-winning 67 Burgundy GTO with parchment interior, manual transmission, perfect car. Daryl also was the one who finally developed a thought process that says that the GTO convertible pace car was definitely an advanced engineering car. Why? Because only a solid lifter, high-performance engine, NASCAR-type engine from Advanced Engineering, Super Duty engine, is capable of being clocked for 146 miles an hour by USAC and does 13 seconds flat at the Bunker Hill Dragway at 107.48 miles an hour. Roger himself has a magnificent 65 GTO coupe, two-door post sedan. Gorgeous car. If you haven't seen it, make it a point. I myself, Alex Stanley Beloff III, have owned 16 new Pontiacs, 36 used Pontiacs, and the only G-Stock national record holder 1959 Bonneville convertible, Tri-Power. Before there was a GTO, there was this emblem, Tri-Power, known the world over by Pontiac, came out in 1958 in red, white, and blue, 1959 in gold as you see it here. This is what started everything, Tri-Power. It wasn't exclusive to us. Oldsmobile had them. The 58 Eldorado Barrettes had them. But Pontiac was the one who made it famous, especially with the GTO. So before there was a GTO, there was the Tri-Power Pontiacs. And known the world over is this emblem right here. Oh, and by the way, Beloff Pontiac Cadillac GMC truck, Peru, Indiana, with the GTO emblem on the bottom. This is 1972. Cars and music go together. I'm so thankful to have lived in such an era of cars and music. Remember the Eagles, 1972. Take it easy. Standing on a corner in Winslow, Arizona. Such a fine sight to see. It was a girl, my lord, in a flatbed Ford, slowing down to take a look at me. There were so many others. Remember 1966? Mitch Ryder and the Detroit Wheels. Devil with a Blue Dress, and so forth. So keep in mind that music and cars go together. Even in 73, Styx, which my daughter Teresa told me was named after a mythical river in underground Greece, Styx made the song Lady famous. So keep in mind as we talk, cars and music go together, and this is Beloff Pontiac Cadillac GMC. The reason we're here today is because of Daryl Roach. About 4 years ago, he said everybody's saying that this car never existed. Well, before we get into that, I'm going to mention a couple things about me that you may not realize that affects everyone here. I like to go to the Dunkin' Donut or the donut shop on Park Street in Grapevine to have a donut and treat myself once in a while. I'm not supposed to do that, you know, because you have to be nice and slim. A little boy, a grandson, with his mother, came in with his nose pressed against the glass looking at all them donuts. And he looked at me, and he looked at the donuts, and he looked at me again, and he looked at me, and he said, "Are you an old man?" I said, "Well, yes, I am." His mother said, "I'm dying of embarrassment right here." And I said, "Never discourage honesty. We usually lose it with age or entering politics." In my travels from coast to coast, I've been in the luxury car business for 54 years. The first thing that I experienced on Highway 98, Fort Walton Beach going to Pensacola, 1963, was pretty desolate, two lanes. I got a 56 Cadillac Eldorado Seville Coupe with two four barrels in factory air that was beautifully redone, and I'm trying to get to Pensacola to get the two four barrels adjusted because the only dealer close by was in Pensacola, Ronnie Mitchell Lowell's Cadillac. So there was an old service station, picture this in your mind, with a V that comes out to the front. Even Tim Dye says, "I remember those," and had two gas pumps, no pavement. I pulled in there, and this guy who looks just like Jethro, big tall guy, comes out, anxious to help out, and I opened the hood, and I said, "I got these two four barrels, and I need to get them adjusted." I never forgot what he said. "Oh, they don't trust me with tools." I never knew what fear was to that guy. So he said, "I don't even have a screwdriver. Last time I tried to help somebody, they had to send a wrecker to pick the car up." Also, in your travels, you got to be careful where you go. I wanted to make a great impression because I was with Cadillac for 30 years before I sold Pontiacs and Chevrolets, was the top salesman of the year for Chevrolet Pontiac in Indianapolis for many years, Oakland in sales. I pulled in to this dealership in California, and I wanted to make a great impression because the owner had invited me, and I said, "I just love it here in La Jolla, California." He said, "Where are you from, boy?" "La Jolla." "It's not La Jolla, it's La Jolla. La Jolla. All the J's here are silent. You get it? La Jolla. When did you get here anyway?" I said, "Well, it was either Hoon or Hulai." I've never had great respect for the Indianapolis 500 race, even though I lived in Indianapolis 11 years, because the Daytona 500 cars were turning in faster times. The 426 Hemis and some of them were running a lot faster than Indianapolis. So I'm going down Georgetown Road. The race is on. And here's everybody sitting there with coolers and radios and empty beer cans and so on, and the race is going on. This guy's got a radio on. And I said, "Hey, who's winning the race?" He said, "I think it's a blue car." They just don't get it unless you're absolutely at the race. Now, We're going to talk about Peru, Indiana. I was the youngest Pontiac Cadillac dealer in the country at the time. Peru, Indiana is the only city in America that has the fire station that burnt down and the police station that got robbed. The fire station had a fire call. They just had their dinner there, and the place caught fire while they were gone. And John Dillinger was on his way to Chicago late one night on Highway 24 and stopped in, and there's nobody open except the police station. So he robbed the police officer and had his photograph taken with him. Mr. Patrick Roberts, my attorney in Peru, was his father. Peru is also famous for the B-58 Hustler bomber, the fastest nuclear bomber in the world. I was stationed there my last tour of duty in the Air Force. It's also the home of Cole Porter. Now then, selling GTOs, brand new, in the 60s, we're going to get to that in a minute, was the highlight of my life. I've been drag racing seriously since 1954. Not legally, mind you, street racing and so on. It was wonderful to take a young fella and turn on the radio and the loud pipes. Of course, you could see in his eyes he wants to see what it's going to do. And I got on the side of the road there by the dealership, and I just nailed it, dumped a clutch, and smoked the tires for about 30 feet and hit the brakes, and he says, "I'll take it." Yeah. I don't care if I have to sell the kids. I have to have this car. How many cars have you seen that you're ready to sell the kids to own? The GTO was that car. It emitted everything we hold dear. Now then, let's talk about the film which my Connie Beloff, has prepared and produced everything you're going to see today. There's a great deal of time and effort, and we hope you enjoy it. Let's talk about the only 72 GTO convertible pace car ever made. You're seeing it right there on the screen. I spent 1 year, 9 months, and 28 days in the rice paddies of Vietnam and Laos. When I came back, I had a 59 Bonneville convertible. Folks, before there was a GTO, the 59 Bonneville convertible was Motor Trend's car of the year. They had a 76% increase in sales in 1 year. This is what started the birth of the GTO, Tri-Power. The most recognized emblem in the world today, Tri-Power, and certainly the hallmark of most GTOs until 66 when they were abolished by Generous Motors. What was important is, who was responsible for this? John DeLorean, Pete Estes, and several others who are hallmarks. There it is, 348 horse Tri-Power. Why is that important today? Because I went to Indianapolis to Raceway Park, to the National Drags every year, drove my car from my house. This was a bored over 30,000 heads redone, carburetors redone. This is pure stock. Back then, you cannot alter the vacuum linkage for the hydromatic transmission, all vacuum after. It's like a turbo lag. You nail it, makes it, and it takes off. I did everything I could to make it run faster. I had never been beat until I saw a G-Stock national record holder on the quarter panel of a 60 Buick electric convertible from Lafayette, Indiana that he pulled on a trailer. And I got a hold of the announcer who I'd known. Here's the stands, packed with people, the nationals. And I said, "Drag racing is either for liars or cheats." And they said, "Can you expand?" I said, "See that 60 Buick? They never made a new one that'd get out of its own way. He's the G-Stock national record holder, so am I. I would challenge him to a grudge race right here in front of all these people. I drove my car from the east side of Indianapolis. He pulled his on a trailer. I said, "Let's run him off head to head right here on the dark side of the phase lights and go." Of course, you don't have to race me if you don't want to. I knew he was cheating. But I also knew in my head he's 4,650 pounds. I'm 4,150 pounds. I'm hoping that a $500 difference in weight on my 59 Bonneville convertible will give me somewhat of an edge. When the lights turned green, we took off, and that son of a gun stayed with me until I hit the third gear and shifted that hydromatic, and I started to pull away from him, and I beat him by a car length and a half and became the G-Stock national record holder. I did not know that in the audience was Pete Estes, head of Pontiac Motor Division, the father of the 59 Bonneville convertible. His son was Ed Estes, who was general manager of Tutwiler Cadillac in Indianapolis. He was so impressed with that car and me, he came to the dealership. I tossed him the keys and Howard Hauser, and they went for a ride, and I said, you can't break it, have fun with it. And they did. He also found out I've been salesman of the year for four straight years and never lost a product presentation contest. The reason that this is important is we know that Pontiac was third. Third place in sales, it's unheard of. And we were Bodotrans Car of the Year four times in 10 years. I had a 62 Bonneville convertible, 421 tri-power. Every place that I worked, if they traded for an old car nobody wanted, they always came to me to make more money for a deal, and I bought it, and they were usually nasty cars, basket cases, but I made them go. Next. I became the youngest Pontiac Cadillac GMC truck dealer in the country when I was 31 in Peru, Indiana. This place was a dump. This place was a filthy hole. It had the worst service reputation in America. Nobody would even go there. You had to, if you went to the service department, you had to have your shot records up to date so you wouldn't catch anything. When they finally came to me, they said, we want you to be the dealer in Peru, Indiana. I said, I don't know anything about being a dealer. He said, you know how to sell. That's what we need. We need for you to develop a clientele where none existed. We need some Pontiac excitement, Cadillac. We need for you to come in. I used to be a part-time salesman at this dealership when I was in the Air Force, so I knew the town and I knew the dealership well. We sprayed gallons of muriatic acid all over the shop floor so much one night, the doors were open, the police stopped because they thought the place was on fire. We had masks on and just boiling, and we hosed it all down, painted the gray epoxy on the floors, painted the walls, painted everything, put hoses for the exhaust pipes, all new electrical outlets. I wonder OSHA didn't close this place up. We needed a drawing card. We needed something to bring people to this dealership to let them know we're new. We want you. We would love for you to come in our service department. We'd love for you to talk to the mechanics. We'd love for you to talk to us. We'll show you the invoice on a car. We still have to make a profit, so don't complain. But we knew how to merchandise vehicles, so we had a grand opening. I contacted Jimmy DiPuzzo in Indianapolis, who had the 38th Street car wash and knew best inside man alive, knew everybody worth knowing. And I said, Jimmy, I need some kind of a drawing card for this new dealership. He said, how would you like to have a race car driver? I said, I can't afford that. He said, yes, you can. He said, and how would you like to have a $100,000 brand new Indy race car on your showroom floor? I said, I can't afford that either. He said, yes, you can. I want you to meet Doris and Grant King. Grant King is the largest independent builder of championship race cars, midget cars, and sprint cars in the country. Loved and respected by AJ, all of them. They came with the cars, we met, and we had a marvelous grand opening. There's the car. Can you imagine 1972 on your showroom floor? We taped all the windows, invitation only. We invited everybody who would breathe to come and see this car and to see us. What an event. While we were there in this huddle right here, that's Jimmy DiPuzzo in the middle. I apologize. Because the reproduction isn't as best as we like with the lighting. That gorgeous woman is Doris King, and I'm the fellow on the left. I was skinny then, had more teeth and more hair. What's interesting is, Doris says, Alex, why can't we get Pontiac to pace the race? Indy Sprints, Indianapolis, several other races, Hoosier 100 and so on. I said, that's a great idea. Pontiac hadn't paced the race since 1958. She said, I can make all the arrangements. You'll get star publicity. Wayne Wessels from Pontiac was there. Fred C. Wrestler is the zone manager for Pontiac Motor Division. He is a student of Pete Estes. He's a brilliant guy. I've known him for a long time. And I called him up And I said, Fred, he's in Chicago. We need a pace car. We need a GTO convertible pace car. And I know we don't make a convertible in a GTO in 72. Why can't we take a Le Mans Sport convertible, I'll order every conceivable feature there is on the sheet. But, Fred, here's the tough part. I need for you to call Advanced Engineering and have them stuff a NASCAR Super Duty 455 high performance engine and transmission turbo hydromatic in this car at the plant. And you got to make it a GTO at the plant. I mean, the emblems in the grill, the decals on the quarter panels, the deck lid, and so forth. He said, we can do that. I said, Fred, you're not understanding something, Fred. None of you have had to make a living in the field at the point of sale. This is serious. The 1968 Plymouth Road Runner ate our lunch. If you don't remember it, I've been drag racing, especially Chrysler products, for a long time. That 383 torque flight was brutal. Had 440 heads, and it was designed to make your feelings hurt if you got up next to one. And you could buy them for $3,000. And they sold 50,000 of them in 68. And I'm telling this to Fred Ressler. And I said, it gets better. In 69, they sold 90,000. And that's not counting the Hemis and the Chargers and so on. So our GTO image is faded badly. Then, in all your infinite wisdom up there in Detroit, in 1971, you come out with regular gas. So now the 455 is neutered and anemic. Heck, a Corvette's only got 180 horsepower. Lawnmower's got more horsepower today. This is serious, Fred. We need something to get showroom traffic, to build enthusiasm, to build excitement, to have people say, gosh, even if you don't have a race car, just to have a Pontiac would be cool, because they're great. He said, you're absolutely right. You're not the only dealer that's been belly aching about this. They built the car. And I said, wait a minute. There's more. He said, uh-oh. I said, this is a VIP car for Doris King. I've got the numbers and everything all here. And I need this car built in 3 days. I said, hello? Fred, are you still there? He said, excuse me, I'm trying to find my pills. 3 days? He said, all right, I'll handle it. Don't send in your order sheet, phone it in. We don't have time for the mail. Now, you need to stand by your phone, because the moment it rings from Plant 8 in Detroit, you got to go pick up the car personally. I said, I can do that. Here's all of the information. Folks, I have every build sheet, every document, every scratch paper, every scribble, everything imaginable. I have it. I've got it all. I'm not dreaming this up. Why? Because there are people who say, that's a myth. How do we know they did that? Any dealer can slap on some GTO emblems and call it a pace car. I got a call at 11 o'clock at night. Pontiac, Michigan. Pontiac, Detroit. Plant 8. Gate 15. Between Jocelyn and something else. With all of the security numbers. Mr. Beloff, you need to personally be there to pick up this GTO pace car convertible when it gets off a refinishing off of the assembly line. I said, I'll be there. Two of my employees, we hopped up in our GMC truck and we were there at 4 a.m. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you, seeing that red GTO with the GTO in the grills, the exhaust splitters, the emblems on the quarter panels and the deck lid, when they fired it up, most all the workers are gathered around it. This was the most exciting thing to happen to them in a long time, because when you fired it up, it rattled the walls. If that don't move you, you have no soul. We were so excited. It's a GTO convertible. Is it a myth? Not to us, not to the workers who assembled it. And if you try to find somewhere in the archives where they did all this, save your looking. You think they want every dealer in the country to force them to build one? We hopped in the car and we took off and headed for Peru, Indiana. We stopped at my mom's in Toledo, served us breakfast. The moment that we got into Peru, all of my guys are gearheads. There's the original window sticker of the car, which Connie went ahead and acquired for me. Then you're going to see the actual newspaper article right there. All my guys in my service department, handpicked by me, are gearheads. The moment it came in, we put a set of Mickey Thompson competition headers. We took the stock exhaust off and we put a can, which looked like a muffler, wasn't nothing in it, with a pipe through it. And we rejetted the carburetor for mountain climbing. I want you to know something. I've had a lot of fast cars. I had a brand new 426 Hemi Dodge in 65 that I drag raced. When that torque flight shifted from first to second, you could feel the frame of the seat in your back. This car was quicker, faster. At 50 miles an hour, you could nail it and it'd go sideways in the street. It never ran out of breath. But a lot of people saying, oh yeah, sir, it's a myth, it's a myth. Darrell Roach said the most amazing thing I never even thought about. He said, Alex, wasn't that car clocked by the USAC officials in Indianapolis at 146 miles an hour for Grant King? I said, yes, it was. And not only that, but A.J. Foyt, Mario Andretti, Andy Granatelli, they were all there. They saw it. He said, it has to be a solid lifter advanced engineering engine. Otherwise, it'll run out of breath. A stock 455 and 72 isn't capable of them kind of speeds. And I told this Fred Ressler. I said, don't embarrass us. I don't want that thing, because Jim Hurtubise is going to be the driver. You'll see his name on the front fender. He's the Novi driver, who was a Miller High Life guy, very famous. His hands got burnt in a Novi fire. And the surgeon says, the way I make your hands, Jim, is the way they're going to be the rest of your life. He said, I want them to grip a steering wheel. And they did. Jim Hurtubise drove this car. He said, this is an amazing piece of engineering. I'm telling you, when it went around that track, it rattled the countryside. This almost like open headers. And of course, you have to have a licensed driver to drive them, because remember, some dealer ran into the photo stand at Indianapolis a couple of years ago and hurt some people. What's important is Darrell Roach was correct. And so was the advanced engineering people. I said, I don't want to be embarrassed with this GTO convertible going out there and it just runs out of breath. It never did. And it paced 9 races throughout the country. What's even more important is I got a call from the owner of the Winchester 400 racetrack. Now, those of you who are not familiar, Winchester in Indiana is the deadliest track in America. 23 drivers have been killed on that track. There are no rules. This is a paved half-mile oval, and there's absolutely no rules. The big problem that they've had in the past with the pace cars is that these guys are serious racers. And when they get out there, they've actually clipped the pace car when the green flag went down. So he said, we want your GTO convertible pace car, and we want it to pace the race. They had a huge regalia, all the events and so on. But here's what was important. When that car paced the race, we're trying to get the footage for you. We are now looking at the only 1972 GTO convertible pace car ever made at the Winchester 400 track in Winchester, Indiana. This is the deadliest track in the country at the time. 23 drivers have been killed on this track. There are no rules. These are serious racers. They are out to race. In the past, the pace car has actually been clipped by some of the race car drivers because they couldn't get out of the way. The owner of this track specifically said, I want the 72 GTO convertible pace car from Beloff, Pontiac, Cadillac, GMC in Peru, Indiana, because it was clocked at 146 miles an hour by USAC. This is the car we want. Here it is being staged at the Winchester track, preparing for the race itself. There it is. It's not a myth. ladies and gentlemen and enthusiasts, that is the 72 GTO convertible pace car. Remember, GTO didn't make a convertible in 72. This is from Pontiac Advanced Engineering, and here it is at Winchester. This is a paved half-mile oval, and it is treacherous. The purpose of the pace car is to slow down all the race cars and line them up perfectly. Some of these people are historic. The numbers on the race cars, we're going back 47 years. This is 1972. There's the 455 high-performance solid lifter Pontiac Advanced Engineering engine, and there's the car. As we see it from the photography stands where I was filming this myself personally, you can see the cars going around the track for hot laps, getting ready for the race. This racetrack started in 1929. There have been drivers been ripped to pieces in crashes, and they just run over the body parts and keep racing. So you can see why this is such a popular event, and it is extremely dangerous. That's why they wanted the pageantry and so forth in the history of this one-of-a-kind pace car. Look at these cars. That's number 17. Look at the way the engineering is done to force air into the engine so that it will get the maximum amount of performance. You can even see some of the race drivers' names. That's Miss Indiana right there. Miss Dry Power 400 was also there. They're all being escorted out towards the track and to the pace car. Here comes the pace car with the owner of the track. There's the band that was playing, and this is a parade lap going around the track. You can see the way it scoots. Remember, Jim Hurtubise was the original driver. Here it comes around the track again. This is tremendously, hysterically happy times for race drivers. Notice how the pace car is lining up all the race cars. Their hands are in the air. It just went underneath the stands to start the race. They're going around one more time, and they'll get ready to drop the flag. Watch carefully, because the pace car will... Here it is. The pace car is coming in off of the track, and the race is on. There are serious racers. Look at the fans. Everybody's on their feet. Everyone's on their feet, even in the pits. It is extremely exciting because it's unpredictable. Here's the pace car because there was a serious incident on the track. So it's lining them up again so that they can race. And here comes the pace car. This car is so quick you can nail it at 50 miles an hour and it'll just go sideways in the street. It is an advanced turbo hydromatic from Advanced Engineering with the 455 engine from Advanced Engineering, including all the drivetrain components. It's a factory air car. And all the suspension was designed for track and drag strip use. So it handles like a race car. And it's very loud. It has headers, a set of Mickey Thompson headers. And here it is, the start of the race again. And here they come, very proudly styling in the pace car. Here it is again, coming around the track. Is it a myth? Some lame person said, some dealer just slapped some GTO emblems on it, call it a pace car. Wrong. It's not a myth to all of these drivers. And remember, there are people out there like A.J. Foyt, Mario Andretti, the Unsers, Bettenhausen, because they don't race just championship cars. They race stock cars, midget cars, dirt track cars. So there are many famous people on this track. This is going back 47 years. Look at the fire. There's a fire in the middle of the pits, and nobody's paying attention to it. What did it do? Roasting weenies? They're watching the race. They are very serious about the race. Now, this time I got up on top of the stands to go over the top of the track. It's a little bit dangerous, but for an amateur photographer, I wanted to catch the pace car going underneath the stands, and there it is. Timeless photography and a timeless race. That's my daughter, Teresa Lynn Beloff. She's 5 years old. This is the 1973 Pontiac Granville Brougham convertible pace car that was driven by Doris King also for the year 73. We couldn't get a GTO, but we did get a Granville convertible with a 455 tri-power from Advanced Engineering. And you'll see the tri-power intake and carburetors in just a moment. There it is, Beloff, Pontiac, Cadillac, GMC, Peru, Indiana. We even painted the wheels the Rally two wheels to match it. There's Jim Herdeby's, the race car driver. Notice the 455 emblem and Tri-Power emblem, which is now famous. There it is, 455 Tri-Power from Pontiac Advanced Engineering. Somebody made a lame remark that, oh, they just put a 66 Tri-Power on the car. Wrong. Volumetric efficiency is completely different. And there's Teresa standing by the pace car. Our 75 Pontiac Bonneville Brougham convertible pace car coming out of the body shop is the same body style. And of course, 75 was the last year for rear wheel drive. This is capturing history at its finest. Notice the 73 brand new Coupe de Ville in the background. So what you're seeing is actual footage for the very first time in 47 years. Now that's Larry Conrad on the fender, our Secretary of State. He drove the car, who was an avid race car driver. And that's Teresa. Notice the sun tachometer on the steering column in this. And there she is with the 73 Coupe de Ville. It was my personal car as a dealer. You have to excuse me. I'm not walking very well because I'm intoxicated. That's okay, isn't it? Good. This pen right here, I gave to Merle Bentenhausen at the Michigan Twin when our car was pacing the race. That's Gary Bentenhausen's brother. The car was owned by Doris and Grant King. He signed my pit pass with this pen for the last time, because the very first lap that he made, he hit the guardrail and tore his right arm off. Was that a myth that the pace car was at the Michigan Twin? Was that a myth that it was at Pocono? Was that a myth that it was at Winchester? Was it a myth for A.J. Foyt and Mario Andretti going through Gasoline Alley when Doris King was saying, this is the most exciting car I've ever been behind the wheel of? I get a police escort to the track. It is so loud and so much fun. Everybody loved this car. I did have a stipulation. When the racing was done, Pontiac, you have to understand something. When you sign a dealer selling servicing agreement, you just can't do as you darn well please. Cadillac Motor Car Division is the boss, but Pontiac was business management control. So if it was Olds Cadillac, Olds would be business management control. Pontiac said, you just completed a ninth race. The car goes in your shop. It's locked up. Not even you are allowed in the service department. It came at 1 a.m. with a great big white truck with this red emblem on it and being pulled by a new 72 Granville Brougham four-door hardtop. And they removed carefully the engine, the transmission, and the drive shaft, put it inside the van to go back to Advanced Engineering, and installed a brand new 455 turbo hydromatic drive shaft and so on, and the car had to be sold. The GTO emblems were removed, it was remained a Le Mans Sport, and I sold it to a young man in Anderson, Indiana, who traded in a beautiful red 66 442 Oldsmobile. I've kind of lost track of the car. It also had the only set of Goodyear tires made. They only made 600 sets of these polysteel Goodyears. Right next door to my dealership at Beloff Pontiac Cadillac GMC was a big Goodyear dealer. And he put a set on there. He said, get those uniroyals off there, boo! You have to have Goodyear tires. So we did put Goodyear tires on the car. By the way, there's a letter from the Chamber of Commerce to me that in 18 months, Mr. Beloff, who has been involved in every community effort we have, has broken every sales record in Miami County in 18 months that existed for Cadillac, Pontiac, and GMC truck. And one of the things is, here is a 72 Pontiac Ventura that I have for sale. Our price, $2,543. It's real. It's a nice car, too. I don't know what you can buy for $2,500 anymore. Not much. So what it did was, it gave us an opportunity to have a great car. For 73, we took a Granville Brougham convertible. Doris King wanted this car. Pontiac Advanced Engineering put a tri-power for this 455. Now, there's some lame person out there that said, oh, they just took a 66 intake manifold and stuck it on there. If you look carefully, they're not even close. The volumetric efficiency of the intake, everything is all different. The carburetors are different. And if it's not such a great piece of engineering, how come Pontiac Advanced Engineering took it back after the race was over? They commandeered it and made it stock. After that, I sold the dealership. Why? Because I study trends. You want to be successful in the car business, which is the most cash-hungry business on earth. A used car manager can steal more than you can pay him. You really got to pay attention to what's going on. I saw the fuel embargoes from OPEC coming a mile away. I can remember, I don't know how many of you, there were gas lines around the block to get 10 gallons. No gas. Forget how much it costs. If you can't get any gas, a Pontiac Granville looked like an aircraft carrier. I sold out. People said, you worked so hard, why did you sell out? I said, because if you're not careful, you're going to lose your shirt. And a lot of small dealers did. Big dealers had deeper pockets, but they also had deeper expenses. Consequently, it led to a great career, because just like in drag racing, it is not a place for the unprepared. You go out there on that track, you better have your stuff together, because you're going to get beat, and there's nothing more humiliating. Just like in the car business, you better have your act together, you better be on top of your game and understand what's going on. I am going to be here. I've got three ring binders here to talk to anybody who wants to visit as long as you want. I'll stay here, doesn't matter, stay here all afternoon, because it's a privilege for me to speak to each and every one of you, because I was never so impressed when I looked out there and I saw all these GTOs glistening in the sunlight. Wow, it's like going back in history. It's like you feel it, you know, if that don't grab you, you're in the wrong place. But I've seen all kinds, little kids, big kids, small kids, short, fat, ugly, everything, pretty. They're all going, oh, wow, oh, look at this. I used to have one years ago. I don't know why I sold it. Well, you have captured that for all of us and brought that back to life. And not just the GTO, but all old cars, whether they're Chevrolets or Oldsmobile, because Pontiac can't exist without Chevrolet or Oldsmobile or Buick or Cadillac, and they can't exist without Pontiac. But we have a unique arena, because we know that the Pontiac is not here anymore. Neither is Saturn. Neither is Hummer. I told a Saturn dealer friend of mine, who I've known for years up in Wisconsin, I said, you got four Saturn stores, you better sell them. He said, Beloff, what are you smoking? I said, I'm telling you, you better get rid of them. He said, we're doing great. Now it's got four stores with grass growing through the cracks at $60,000 a month for lights, heat, and taxes, and there's nothing being sold. Then the Hummer with that great big H, what do you do with that place? They're gone. And then Oldsmobile, and Pontiac, and then Plymouth, and on and on and on. So we can remember fondly a great time and now share it with other people, because the styling of your cars, the image that they have is timeless. It's priceless. And just to be close to one, when Connie took me up there to the Wisconsin Dells, and I'm looking at all these Pontiacs, I hadn't been to a Pontiac, because I'm also a member of the Cadillac LaSalle Club. I've had several national winners for Cadillac. But I'm looking at all these Pontiacs from the, what do you call it, balcony.
Oh, balcony.
Looking at all these, and that's just part of them in Wisconsin. It's a great feeling just to see those cars. Okay. Okay, keep going.
So what cars do you now have in your possession?
I have a 1991 Cadillac Fleetwood Brougham rear-wheel drive 5.7-liter LT1 Corvette. They were standard in Cadillacs from 91 through 96. It was made and assembled in Texas by Texans at Arlington. All rear-wheel drive Cadillacs came from Clark Avenue in Detroit for 60 years. Because it has a truck frame under it, it was made in Arlington. Now, of course, we know they make trucks. It just won first place for Cadillac LaSalle for the state. We have in the body shop a 1975 Pontiac Granville Brougham convertible. I've been looking for that car for 10 years. I finally saw it in the Pontiac magazine. I called Alvin up there in Pennsylvania. I said, I want to buy your car. It looked like a toad. The picture of it, everybody said, ugh. No wonder he didn't get any calls. I said, Alvin, I want to buy your car. The reason I wanted it, I wanted a 6-passenger car. I wanted rear wheel drive, factory air, power seats, power windows, power door locks, rally tune suspension, tilt steering wheel, because if I get my fat hiney in there without a tilt wheel, then I'm stuck. I've been through it. It had to have rally two wheels and so forth. It had all of that. And I said, Alvin, I want to buy your car, but I can't afford it. He said, well, what can you afford? I said, well, first of all, the top is shot. I got to put it in an enclosed trailer and ship it to Grapevine, Texas. That's going to be $1,700. He said, okay, get to the bad news. So I told him what I could afford. Silence. And I hear in the background, Alvin, you're 82 years old. You're too damn old to fool around with these old cars. You let that man have that car and get it out of here. You got too many cars now as it is.
Yes, dear.
He's got this great big metal building where he keeps all his cars and great big John Deere tractors. His sons run the place now. He spent a lot of money in the right place for it. So I end up with the car. So I got this 67 Pontiac Grand Prix convertible from Darrell Roach. It's still in dry storage at his place out in the farm. And I wanted to redo that car too. And what did I hear from Connie? Alex, you're too damn old to fool around with these old cars. You need to get rid of that car. That's it, we're not restoring any more cars. So I succumbed to the same thing that Alvin did. But anyway, I'm donating the car to the Lone Star chapter and to the Pontiac Museum. So when it's finally finished, we'll have something that we can style around Dallas-Fort Worth. Interested in Pontiacs? Call this number. A lot of people don't know. You just mentioned a business card, something. A lot of people would like to know. They just don't know. So that's at the moment where we're at. But I've had a lot of great cars, and I'm very, very thankful to every one of them. So there's the letter from the Chamber of Commerce. There's Darrell Roach and I at his farm with the Grand Prix convertible. And there's the 75 Granville. We did it right. I pulled everything off. No interior, no bumpers, no headlights, no taillights. They block sanded this car 3 times just to get it straight. Now the interior has been completely redone. It's a beautiful car. I've had everything that can be removed, re-chromed, and replated, even some of the things that weren't plated from the factory. And Calvert's in Denton is rebuilding the engine as we speak. I'm having the heads redone at about $900 because I want a little bit more oomph than it had. So I do want to put tri-power on the car. I do have the original tri-power emblems and the 421 emblems because when they probably bore it 30 thousandths, that's about where it'll be. So that's about it. And of course, I love the Tiger because I remember going to Pontiac in Detroit when they were doing this ad. The Tiger ripped up 3 interiors before they could finally get them to sit still. Can you imagine a Tiger that size? Say, okay, so hold it, sit still now. Just ripped the seats to pieces. And there it is, all of the cars that I've owned. If you have an interest, you should go online and see them because there's some real barn finds in there too. I had a 1962 Pontiac Grand Prix in California. A man called me, who I've known for years, who was responsible for all this property. He said, the property's been sold. There's a Grand Prix in this barn. I said, come on. He said, I know what I saw. It's a 62 Grand Prix. Well, you couldn't even open the doors because of the weeds. So you peek in there, sure enough, 62 Grand Prix with enough silt on it to sink the Titanic. We finally got the doors open. You couldn't even see inside. 4 flat tires. I don't know how they got it in there. You couldn't open the doors. There's no room. I bought it. He got a title. got on a winch and hauled it out of there, put four tires and wheels on the car, put it on a flatbed, shipped it to Benicia, California, to my house. People were honking and waving because it's got a black California plate, meaning we can trace the car to its origin in California. We can trace it to its delivering dealer. I buffed and cleaned that car, took all the seats out, did it the right way. The seats, the interior was perfection. Nothing was faded from the sun because it's been in that barn for 15 years. And so it was beautiful. The carpets were shot. The body was rust-free. I never tried to start it or run it. People were stopping by my house fighting with satchels of cash and guns to buy that car. So I finally sold it. That's where two fools met. And I sold the car. So if you're interested in Pontiacs, I'm sure I'll probably have. I've had, I think, six or seven 59s, seven or eight 63s. What was interesting about the 63 Pontiac Grand Prix? If you open the hood, you could start it without a key. When you open the hood, there's a threaded shaft that comes up right there at the firewall, and right next to it's a little black box. I can't remember what it does, but I had my screwdriver and I was trying to move something and I touched that threaded shaft to the box and the car started. So anyway, they changed that in 64 because I did have a brand new 64 Grand Prix. My first new car I bought, I was 23 years old, bought that car, and it was a 421 four barrel, but I kept the flags off it. Flags back then came in the glove box and the dealer installed them on the fenders. And people used to pair off with me and said, that's the strongest running 389 I ever did see. Well, of course, the 64 had a sorry transmission in it. That roto hydromatic, when it would shift, it'd go, oh. I said, well, what happened? Did we run out of gas? Well, the turbo hydromatic that came out in 65 was a huge advancement because it would never get hotter than 300 degrees. It was absolutely brutal, even with a two barrel. And it was a vast improvement. So the 65 Grand Prix was an absolute winner. Anyway, again, I thank all of you so much for your attention. It is, again, a thrill to be up here and speak to all of you. And I hope I get to know each and every one of you. And even though I don't have a GTO anymore, maybe Connie will save some of my donut money and I can afford the membership to join your club. Thank you.